My dear friends in Christ, I welcome you all to this night's message. Today we are going to take a quick reading from Job chapter 1. Incidentally, we are going to read the whole of that chapter. Job chapter number 1. I am reading from New King James Version. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright, and the one who feared God and shunned evil. And 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. Also, his possessions were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household, so that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. And his sons would go and feast in their houses each of his appointed day, and they would send and invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. So it was, when the days of feasting had run their course, that Job would send and sanctify them. And he would rise early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them of all. So Job said, "It may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." Thus Job did regularly. Now, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Almighty God, the Lord of heaven and earth, and the Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, "From where do you come from?" So Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? That there is none like him on earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil." So Satan answered the Lord and said, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him and around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now, stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Job, "Behold, all that he has is in your power. Only do not lay a hand on this person, his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. Now, there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and the messenger came to Job and said, "The oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them when the Sabaeans raided them and took them away. Indeed, they have killed the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, another also came and said, "The fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I alone have escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, another also came and said, "The Chaldeans formed 3 bands, raided the camels, and took them away. Yes, and killed the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, yet another also came and said, your sons and your daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And suddenly, a great wind came from across the wilderness, and they struck the four corners of the house, and it fell on the young people, and they are dead. And I alone have escaped to tell you. Then Job arose, tore his robe, and shaved his head, and he fell to the ground and worshipped God. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return there. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin, nor change God, or not charge God with wrong. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to you, O God. Dear friends in Christ, the story of Job is a very familiar story for every child of God, every Christian. Even non-Christians, they know the story of Job. Sometimes when people are suffering too much, and they say, oh, you're suffering like Job. Or are you suffering like Job? So Job has become synonymous with suffering. It has become a name associated with affliction, with turmoil, with unending problems, serial attacks. I'm not going to go through the story of Job. That is not the focus of this message, because we all know the story of Job. We all know how Job suffered. We all know that Job was a true character of suffering, one whose faith was really tested by the enemy. But today we are going to look at a different reflection from the life and the character of Job. Job has become more or less what I may call a phenomenon, a character that every child of God must have. That character of Job, a persevering character. Before I get into the message of this night, my dear friends in Christ, I do want to let you know that it was the devil, the Satan, the enemy, that tested Job, or tempted Job. Job was tempted, and he paid the price of his faith. It seems to us that many of us think that Christian faith is really come to know Christ and everything will be easy. I do not preach that kind of message because it's not the true reality. When you give your life to Christ, you should be ready to have your faith tested. Now, my dear friends in Christ, it was the enemy that tempted Job. God does not tempt us, although he may test us. For example, God tested Abraham, not tempting Abraham. We need to know that difference. So what we're dealing with this night is a case of tempting. Scripture tells us that Satan is the father of lies, that you find in Job, in John chapter 8, verse 44. That he's a liar and he's the father of lies. And that speaks a lot about the enemy. He always lying in all things in order to deceive a child of God and make him to rebel, so that he will be like the enemy. He will be like Satan. Satan has been doing this all these years, centuries upon centuries. And permit me to say that he is an expert in tempting and trying the children of God. He has been doing it all these years. So we would expect him to be a merchant of tempting. He cannot tempt more than him. Of course, temptation comes from him. Anything that has to do with temptation comes from the devil. And in the story we have just read, it was the character of Job that was tested. Job was tested. The person, the dignity of Job, his faith value was tested. And bear in mind that as this message is going on, use your tongue to count your teeth. Because even though we will be mentioning the name Job in this ministration, by virtue of which Job actually is the character, the major focus, the principal character in the message. However, you may be that Job. It may be your story we're talking about. And so Job was tested, and he was greatly tested. God allowed it to happen for a purpose, to bring glory to his name. Now, even though that Job was tested, in fact, tested to the highest magnitude. However, Job did not fall in spite of all the series of temptations. He did not fall. He continued to trust in God. Job did not give up. Job continued to stand his ground. Jesus. My dear friends in Christ, the enemy was fully out to destroy the life of Job. The enemy was fully out to cripple the life of Job. In fact, the enemy wanted to prove to God that Job would disappoint him. And I do want to let you know that anytime we are passing through trials in life, problems, challenges in life, God has told the enemy that you are his servant, that he is trusting, that you trust God, that you will not fail him. And so there's a very big stake God has made on you. God is actually proud of you. Jesus. And so, my dear friends in Christ, in the life and the situation Job passed through, we see a man who had it more than enough. The enemy was fully out to cripple Job by bringing out the worst attacks against Job. Satan opened his barrack, opened his arsenal, brought out his weapon of warfare, and he came to attack an innocent man. Remember the Bible made it clear in Job chapter 1, where God in verse 1 introduced Job. Look at the introduction of Job. God said that Job was a man from the land of Uz, and he was blameless and upright, and he feared God, and he shunned evil. You see that? That was that first sentence in Job chapter 1 verse 1 introduces Job as a righteous man. As a righteous man, but in spite of his righteousness, the enemy came against him. Number one, the enemy sent the Sabians to steal Job's oxen and assets. They stole his oxen, his assets. Job had so many assets. In Job chapter 1 verse 2, the Bible says he had 7 sons and 3 daughters that were born to him. And he had, in verse 3, the Bible says in Job chapter 1 verse 3, and he had great possessions. 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household, so that this man was greatly wealthy in the province of the east. So we're talking of a very wealthy man, not just a wealthy man, very wealthy man. But the enemy came, sent human instruments, possessed them as enemies. The Bible called them the Sabaeans, S-A-B-E-A-N-S, Sabaeans. And these who came and they stole Job's oxen and the assets. And this you will find in Job chapter 1, verse 14 to 15. This was number one attack. Attack number two. The enemy sent lightning to that struck and destroyed Job's property, even killing some of his employees. You find that in Job chapter 1, verse 16. Number three, the Chaldeans robbed Job of camels, which were probably worth more than Job's oxen and assets. And this you'll find in Job chapter 1, verse 17. Number four, then Job had the devastating news. The enemy sent a mighty wind, a hurricane, a tornado that came and paralyzed the whole occasion going on, a festival going on, feasting going on, in which the children of the 10 children, all of them, were the ones involved in that occasion. And behold, the wind pulled down the building and killed all the 7 children of Job. This you find in Job chapter 1, verse 18 to 19. And as if that is not enough, Satan attacked Job's health, and he became leprous. He became very, very sick. A wealthy man living in a palace, he started to live on the dunghill where people threw their trash. That was where Job was living. He was barricaded by the people. Because when you have leprosy in your life, you cannot be found to be part of the public any longer. So he was quarantined. And this you'll find in Job chapter 2, verse 1 to 10. It's not yet okay enough. Satan entered Job's wife and made her suggest to Job to curse God and die. What a heartbreak. The only person that is supposed to be encouraging Job in all these things, having lost everything, would have been his wife. But the wife suggested, why don't you curse God and die instead of living life this way? As Job was trying to recover from that shock, behold, look at his three friends that cared about the ordeal, the temptations, the crisis that Job was passing through. And they left their province and came to visit their fellow rich man. Do you know that when they came close to Job, they were at loss, they were at shock. Because they saw what they least expected to see. They saw a shadow of Job. Could this be Job? The Bible says that these three men, these three friends of Job, were standing up 7 days. No word came out of their mouth. They didn't eat food. They didn't drink water. They were standing in amazement at a shock. They could not believe what they were seeing. And instead of encouraging Job, they added salt to the wounds. Oh. Remember the story, what was said at the beginning of this message. Use your tongue to count your teeth. Perhaps you may be that Job. Maybe your friends are laughing at you now. Maybe your health is in serious jeopardy now. Maybe those in the house, people are supposed to be encouraging you, are the ones laughing at you. Perhaps you have lost all your investments and none of them is working. You have spent all these years to make careful planning on how life will end up for you, how you are going to spend certain stage of your life, only to find out that you have wasted your time. Maybe the business is not going. Maybe business climate has changed and the things are going so horrible for you. Or maybe your children that you invested in are heartbreak in your life and not even showing appreciation that you have labored to raise them. And maybe they're not even taking care of you or don't even listen to what they're saying. That is an attack. That is a scheme to cripple your life. The hand of God is not there. It is the enemy. So, we have seen the report card of Job. A man that the Sabians stole all his oxen and assets. A man that lightning struck and destroyed his investments and even killed his employees. A man that the enemy used the Chaldeans to rob his camel and take so many of his assets, the one that remained. A man that lost all his children. And the only thing left was his wife in the house. And behold, even the house, the wife told him, curse God and die. And now a man who used to be wealthy, who never knew what it means to be poor, now he has become very poor. Now he used not to know what hospital meant. Perhaps he was using his money to even to pay people's bills in the hospital, but never going there for any reason because he was always healthy. Now look at him sick. Even sleeping in the dung hill, in the smelling dung hill. His house. And now, instead of friends comforting him, friends have come to add crisis upon Christ for him. This is the report card of Job. What is your own report card, brother? What can I see in your report card? Jesus. Oh, maybe in your own report card, there are days of dumpster on your life. As if the whole world is dumping garbage on your life. As if there is no end to crisis in your life. Maybe that is your report card. Hospital bills hanging up and down. Divorce paper today. Pay cuts tomorrow. Betrayers next tomorrow. Maybe that is your own story. What do you do when an entire truck of sorrow is dumped on you? What did you do? The answer to that question will be doing what Job did. Job, in his crisis, trusted God. Job, in his troubles, depended on God. Troubles upon troubles. That was the life of Job. Remember, things used to go well for him. Jesus. I'm beginning to think that it seems to me that the enemy brought Job into a boxing ring and was punching him on the face. Punching him on his life, punching every part of his life. And that's actually what happened to Job. Job was in the enemy's boxing ring. The enemy gave Job 7 deadly punches, which we have already enumerated. Oh, wait a minute. Are there some punches you are receiving right now from the enemy? Are you in the enemy's boxing ring? Is enemy punching you real hard? If your answer is yes, then I welcome you to this night's message titled The Devil's Punch. The Devil's Punch. Jesus. This is a message designed for people who believe that the best way to describe their lives is that they have become victims of devil's punch. The enemies have been punching them here and there, punching their lives, punching their investments, punching their health, punching everything. I want to take note of the first punch the devil gave to Job. Take note of the first punch, brother. Satan had the Sabaeans steal Job's oxen and Job's assets. Let's go back to Job chapter 1, verse 2 and verse 3. And the Bible says, Job had 7 sons and 3 daughters. Also, verse 3, his possessions were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household. So that this man was greatest, take note of that, greatest of all the people of the East. So we're talking about the greatest, the richest man in the East. He lost his wealth overnight. The Sabaeans came and stole the oxen, Job's oxen, stole his assets. The Bible said that he had 500 yoke of oxen. They were all gone. In today's economy, this would have been a theft of several thousand or millions of dollars worth of property. And maybe you do not have a camel or you're not a farmer. But let me tell you, that camel, that oxen was Job's investment. The enemy attacked his investment. The enemy attacked his asset. The fall of the stock market could be an attack against your own asset. The epileptic and the struggling business, although the business used to do well, is an attack against your asset. A wrong operational business decision that has crippled that business or making the business to begin to suffer, like, you know, suffering. The business is not going the way it used to go, like an anemic business. It's because of the attack against your assets. A business could go on a famine. Enemy could bring famine on a business. Remember that the Sabaeans came and they took the oxen as the assets of Job. A business could go on famine because the Sabaeans visited somebody's family, visited somebody's business, visited somebody's life. What is a Sabaean that came to your life or that is at your life right now? Remember in the case of Job, the Sabaeans came, then they took the oxen, 500 oxen. What it has the Sabaean come to do in your life? What is your story like? In 2 Kings chapter 6 verse 25, the Bible says, there was a great famine in Samaria, and behold, they besieged it until a donkey's head was sold for 80 shekels of silver and a fourth of a calf of bulls dung for 5 shekels of silver. You see that? The scripture is telling us that a great famine came to Samaria. Samaria used to be wealthy. Samaria used to be a business hub, a commercial city, a city full of life, teeming with businesses, teeming with immigrants. People are coming from different parts of the Middle East, coming to settle at Samaria. How come Samaria is now having famine? How come businesses in Samaria are now in famine mode? How come? To the point that even the head of a donkey's head could be sold for 80 shekels of silver. Wow. The Bible says that the famine caused the city to suffer. In other words, there was a siege in the city, and the siege caused the famine. There are businesses that are sieged. There are families that are sieged because the enemy has given you a punch. Pow! You don't know you're in a boxing ring. Unfortunately and regrettably, many Christians do not know they're in a war field, and so they relax. They relax. Eating and drinking. Not aware that they are in the war field. How can you be eating choice food, drinking choice wine in the war field? It's not done. But Christians are doing that. That's what you do. That's what we do. When the city was sieged, famine was the result. No more commercial activities. No more transport of goods and services. And the result was that even the head of donkey that was usually not sold, people just threw it away because they don't use it for anything. Then beggars will go and pick it up and maybe use it to eat. But things went so bad that it became an essential commodity. Remember the story of the prodigal son? He was living in his father's house, everything at his disposal, until he told the father, said to me, I want to leave. We know the story, how the father eventually settled him when he couldn't convince him not to leave, and how he squandered his father's wealth, and then he started to walking where pigs were raised. And at the point, he was even looking for the remaining of the food, the ones that pigs could not eat, the ones that were supposed to be thrown away. He was looking for them to eat, but he couldn't even find those ones. And he said, better for me to go back to my father's house, because he has been treating even his servants so well. So let me go back to his house. And he asked if he could even allow me to become a servant in his own house. We know how the story ended. That the moment this young boy made this decision and was coming back to the house, he passed through the door of mercy, and his father embraced him. The father celebrated him. But this young boy was in this famine mood because the enemy sieged him. Many of us are sieged. Now that the head of a donkey has become so expensive, a scarce commodity, that it has become so expensive that it was sold for 80 shekels of silver. That was a lot. Terrible. Oh, wait a minute. Can you imagine what will happen to a company that depends on the donkey's head for their business? Can you imagine that? Do you know there are businesses that depend on certain other businesses or other products for their own business to be sustained? Can you imagine a business in Samaria, a company in Samaria that has a product, the only way they put their product is to depend on the donkey's head as a raw material? Now that a donkey's head that is now costing 80 shekels, perhaps they used to go to the dump stand and pick them up free. But now it's 80 shekels of silver. Do you think that business will still be functional? Of course not. It will go extinct. Because the devil has given that business a punch. The enemy was attacking the business. But the main person on the target could be the owner of the company. But the enemy has seen that it cannot attack the owner of the company right away, and they are going to attack even the people that supply you with your raw materials. Even to attack the vessels, the transportation system that supply you those raw materials. Or bring you the wrong clients in life that will mess up your business or bring you wrong employees to destroy your business. The enemy has closed many companies because the enemy has given them a punch that made them to go into famine mode. It was so terrible in Samaria to the extent that in 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 25, the Bible says, and the king of Israel was passing by, a woman cried out to him and said, "Help me, Lord, O king." It was so bad that women were begging on the street. People were begging. Maybe you used to have surplus, even to the point that you are giving out, training people in school, helping the widows. But now you are begging because the enemy had given you a punch and I've taken your oxen, I've taken your business. I know of a man who used to be very rich, but now he's begging. Begging for bread. My dear friends in Christ, are you this opportunity to lift everyone who are victims of the punch of the enemy on their business? People that the enemy are giving punch in their lives, giving punch in their business enterprise, giving punch in all their investments. May the Almighty God, through this prayer, paralyze that hand that is giving you punch. It is time to punch the enemy. It is time to punch them in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, every hand from the pit of hell, punching my business, punching my life, punching my children, punching my investments, I command you now, in the name of Jesus, be destroyed by fire. Be destroyed by fire. I am punching you back now, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, my people begin to pray. My people begin to pray. May the power of Jesus, let him deliver you. Call on the Lord now. Let the Lord punch them. In the name of Jesus. So, if you're not happy with what the devil is doing in your life, if you're not happy with his punching, it is time to punch him back. It's not the time to run away from him. Many of us have been running away. But the Bible tells us in James chapter 4, verse 7, so resist him, and he will flee from you. Don't be in the running mode. Be in the punching mode. You see that? And most regrettably, many of us start punching the enemy, punching the devil, only when he has punched us first. As if to say that the enemy's punch was a wake-up mode for us. Well, it's good if he punches us and then we start punching him. But it's worse when he punches us and we don't punch back. A lot of people, when they punch you, the devil punches them, then they will even get into the worst situation in life. They don't get up. They don't want to punch back. They don't want to get into prayers. You punch the enemy by doing what? By being a man of prayer, becoming a woman of prayer. Some people, what brought them into prayer is because the devil is punching them. I was talking with somebody some time ago. I said, "Oh, sister, don't see the prayer line again." He said, brother, okay, you understand now? I said, "What do you understand?" He said, you know, we human beings, how we do now. I said, "I don't understand. Tell me." I knew what he was trying to say. I said, "You know, when the problem comes now, we come to the prayer line and get it solved. It's not a good thing. It's not a good way to do it. But this is, I need to tell you, bro, because that's how I do it. That's how my life has been. And I hope that I'm going to change." I told her sister, it's good to serve God. Even when things are going well, you start to serve God. Don't wait for when a punch comes from the devil. The best defense mode is to punch the enemy. Not even wait for him to punch you first. Punch him. Keep punching him. You know that you're a boxer. I wish God will use this prayer line today to raise generation of boxers, spiritual hunters, people that will take their spiritual gun, being the word of God, to shoot down the enemy. Shoot him down. people that will shoot down the enemy sitting on the throne. There are people that the enemy is sitting on their thrones, sitting on their marriage seat, sitting on their testimonies, boasting 50 years. The enemy is boasting. Is that not a shame for a child of God? How can you answer a child of God, as a Christian, when you cannot even chase a common headache from your life? Little headache, you can take one prescription or not. Hello! Jesus! I understand from military point of view that the best way to attack the enemy is not to be defensive, but to combat him. You know, afflict him with prayer. Don't be offensive, not defensive. When you're offensive, then you're not giving him time to even come close to you. Are you in the defensive mode or are you in the offensive mode? Punch him on the face. Jesus. My dear friends in Christ, the second attack on Job was that lightning struck and destroyed his property, killing his employees. There are people, as I'm talking to you, the enemy have sent lightning to strike their life. I visited a woman, in fact, the woman that my wife and I, we use her and the husband as our parents during our sponsors during wedding. And when I came to one of my visits to their family, she showed me something that surprised me. In Nigeria, there's something that's called gari. It's a bag. It has a way, it's what to call a sack of gari. It's always, depending on the height, some of them will be as high, as tall as, a boy, the height of a boy. So she kept this sack of gari at the kitchen. One day, she said she was in the kitchen cooking, and behold, a lightning struck, broke the window, and before her eyes, busted the sack of gari and scattered it on the floor. I saw it with my two eyes. That thunder would have struck her dead. That thunder would have put the house on fire. But God diverted it to where? To something that is inconsequential, just destroying the sack of gari. I don't know the lightning that is channeled against you, the arrow of lightning that have been sent into your life, sent into your business, sent into your destiny, in order to dismay you, in order to paralyze you. May God send that arrow back to the sender in the name of Jesus. Jesus. Arrow of lightning fashioned against me to destroy my life. I command you now, in the name of Jesus, go back to the sender. Arrow of cancer, arrow of terminal disease, Oyakanda Yarabo Kerebu, that have been sent against my life. I command you now, in the name of Jesus, go back to the sender. In Jesus' name we pray. I was talking with a sister some months ago. I said, brother, I was in the dream and I saw something like an arrow that just came into my family. Before I knew what it was, it was a coffin. And before I could scream, hey, look at coffin. I don't know where it came from. It just flew like a rocket. Bam. And I saw you commanded that coffin and said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, go back to the sender. That coffin of death was sent to the family to come and take life. But Jesus said, no, it will not happen. I don't know the arrow that has been sent against your life, against your property, against your investments. I command such arrows, anywhere they may be, let them burst into pieces. Jesus, my people begin to pray now. Every arrow of destruction, every arrow of death, every arrow of shame designed against me from satanic factory, from satanic enterprise, I command them now. Go back to the sender. Arrow of vampire. Arrow of vampire designed against me. I command you now. In the name of Jesus. Get ready to be destroyed now. In the name of Jesus. Every spiritual bomb that has been packed against me, I detonate you now. I detonate you now. Be destroyed by fire. Be destroyed by fire. You cannot explode in my family. You cannot explode in my business. In the name of Jesus. The Bible says in Job chapter 1 verse 16 that the enemy sent the lightning to destroy Job's property, to kill his and kill his employees. Employees. People working for Job. Do you know those employees, they didn't do anything wrong. But the enemy was after Job. The enemy was not after the employees. But because he wanted to destroy Job, to frustrate Job, those employees became victims. Let me tell you something, sister. Do you know that sometimes we suffer? We pass through certain crises in life. We pass through certain experience. We pass through certain attack. Not out of our own making, but because of that we have found ourselves as subject of attack. Based on the fact that we are working under somebody who's under attack. Based on the fact that we are subject to certain authority that the enemy is attacking. And therefore, the arrow is channeled to us. Jesus. Huh? This is why it's good to pray for everybody in your life. Not just your employees. Pray for your employees. Pray for your fellow employees, for your managers. Pray for them. You don't know that because of you, they could be under attack. My mother told me something one day. Listen to this story. Listen carefully. My mother told me, this was December of one certain year. And she told me that she was in the room alone. My mother happened to be a very, very prayerful woman. And all of a sudden, she heard, bah! It was like a bomb explosion. So she screaming, blood of Jesus, blood of Jesus. And she ran out of the house. Meanwhile, my younger ones in the other room, our rooms, came out and said, Mama, what is that? Mama, what is that? My mother said, who threw this bomb in this house? They were laughing at her. I said, Mama, are you okay? How can you expect us at this age? Do we have any big bomb to start with? My mother said that there was an explosion in this house now. She knew what I was talking about. So they told them, Mama, all of us were in this house, and we didn't hear anything. My mother went into prayers, asking God, what is this that happened? You know what God told her? Listen. God told her, ask your son, Owakwe. Now, this was happening in my village. But I was living about 350 miles away from my mother in another state. And the Holy Spirit told my mother, call your son, ask him whether there was an occult man that he was fighting. So my mother had to call me and say, look at what happened just a few days ago. Tell me, do you have any problem with an occult man? I said, woman, you're too much. Incidentally, that time I was doing master's program in one of the universities there. And the first Before I even had my first class, I had a powerful revelation that shook me. And I saw an angel wearing white. He came to me. I was already in the room in that class, the spirit. And he told me, look at the board. And I looked at the board. And I saw a number the angel wrote that started at the beginning of the board to the end of the board. I don't know whether it was over 100 digits. Very long number. And he told me, by way of questioning, can you interpret this number? I told him, no, my Lord. He said, this is the occult level of one of your lecturers. And right there, he gave me the name of the lecturer. I was just a new student. I didn't even know lecturers there. But do you know there was a lecturer with that name? This happened in the world. And this angel told me, be careful with him. This is his spiritual level. This is his spiritual level. He's a grandmaster. In the spirit, this man knew that there was somebody with anointing that came as a student in the department. And so I was always meeting with him in the spirit, fighting. I get into bed to sleep, I will be in war with this man. Even the people that he wanted to kill, I stood in the gap. I said, you cannot destroy them. One day, I had to go meet the church in the pastor. I said, look at the revelation God gave to me. Even though he wasn't even a Christian, but you know, he was shaking when I was telling him that. He said, lock the office, close the office, please. I closed. He said, this thing you told me is true. He now tried telling me the things I've been passing through. Now, why am I talking about this? There was a day I was in a lecturer's office. Remember that I was a student then. I came to one of the lecturers to put me through in a question I had in one of the classes. But he was with another student. So I was waiting for him to finish. So while I was there, what I heard was, bah! The explosion was so massive that I thought that the building had collapsed. With my two eyes, I saw light flash. Vamp! In a split of seconds, I thought that my hands had been dismembered. I thought it was a life explosion. Then I heard a voice that told me, this is a spiritual bomb, but I protected you, my son. And so, this was a reality in my life. When they were trying to get me at all costs, and they couldn't get me, then I said, okay, let's go and attack his mother. Let's go and attack his mother. And it was just about 2 days later, after this explosion I told you that explains, that my mother had her own. And the God told me, he said, the occult man I gave you his name, that you are fighting, that is the man that has sent this bomb to paralyze you, to destroy you. But I protected you. The power of protection. But before this experience, God was already warning me. He said, be careful, be careful, be careful. I didn't know what to tell me to be careful. But something was going on in my life that time. I used to have perpetual night vigil. Every 11 o'clock, I would get up. So I set up my alarm. 11 o'clock, I would start night vigil. Sometimes I would pray till 2, sometimes 3 a.m. Sometimes 4 a.m. It became a natural pattern of my life. Now, a day came when I only wake up in the morning. Alarm will ring and ring and I won't hear it. I will miss morning mass. And it happened consistently. I was praying to God, I don't know what's happening. God warned me. He said, the enemy has found that your strength comes from prayer. But now, he has seen that every effort has made to attack you and destroy you has failed. So what he's using now is to weaken your prayer life. I want to learn something from this. Because when the enemy wants to attack you and destroy you, he wants to come after your prayer life. Because it is through prayer that you get connected to Jesus. And when you are connected to Jesus, nothing can happen to you. Have you asked yourself why? Sometimes when you go and do fasting, somebody provokes you. Somebody makes you to just start quarreling with somebody. You mess up the fasting. Others, when you become so hungry, you can't even hold your throat again from taking that candy. You may start fasting. Or somebody will come and hit the mirror of your car and run away. And you'll be unhappy. Just the enemy wants to take away your joy. And so when the Lord was warning me, he said, "Son, use the weapon of my blood. Be pleading the blood of Jesus all the time." So when I was walking on the road, the Lord said, "As you're walking on the road, be pleading the blood of Jesus. Blood of Jesus. As you're getting to the sea, be pleading the blood of Jesus." So as I was going to that lecturer's office, I was pleading the blood of Jesus continuously, nonstop. Until I came to his office and sat down, I didn't know that something was going to happen. When that explosion took place, the Lord said, "This is spiritual bomb, but I protected you." A lot of people have died just without medical explanation. You call it heart attack. Of course, something will be called the name. You sleep, you didn't wake up. You don't know that a lightning has struck you. You don't know that a spiritual bomb has exploded in your spiritual realm. Is that a young man who was doing so well in a particular game, I think hardball, he was to be recruited for operations, and a day to that day, somebody hit his muscle. He woke up and was crippled. He could not obtain or take that position again. That contract, he couldn't sign it again. Crippling spirit. I am praying for somebody that anything that's attacking you must be granted tonight in the name of Jesus. And so when the enemy saw that they couldn't cripple me, now they said, "Okay, let us go to his mother. Let us go to his siblings. Let us go to his relatives, close relatives. Let us hit him where it will touch him." And let me tell you, if the enemy tries to get you, couldn't get you. If he gets your child, he has gotten you. If he has gotten your parent, he has gotten you. Because when they start crying, you start crying. That's part of your body. That is why when you are praying, you pray for everybody in the house. You pray for your business investments. Amen? Jesus. And so we are praying over our employees, over our siblings, our entire household, our relatives. We soak them, brother of Jesus. Every lightning, every tornado, every hurricane, spiritual hurricane, that have been designed against my life, against my people, let them be destroyed now. In the name of Jesus, let them burn by fire. Oppression burn by fire. Let them burn by fire. In the name of Jesus. Remember the title of this prayer, the devil's punch. But now it is turning into your own punch. You punch the enemy will have wounds. You cripple him. He will fall into the pit he dug for you by your prayer. You box, hit his mouth and his lips will be like, I don't know, whether the leg of a cow. That will be the size of the enemy when you hit the lips. Well, punch. Amen. When David punched him with a stone on the head, he fell down. Punch him with the prayer. Jesus. Number three. The Bible says in Job chapter 1 verse 17, the sardines robbed Job of camels. And those camels were probably even worth more than the Job's oxen. So after taking the oxen in Job 1 verse 14 to 15, in verse 17, the night came and took camels. Many of you have invested in different areas, different assets. Job invested in oxen. He also invested in camels. But the enemy came and took those ones also. Many of you have invested in maybe stock market. Invested in one business or the other. Only to find out that all of them, all those investments have been grounded.
How can it be so? The idea of investing in different businesses is so that if one fails, the other one will carry on. You carry on with the other one. How come that all the 5, 6, 7 investments assets have been crippled at once, as if there was a whistling telling them, get ready, run, and they're all running away from you? I say no more. In the name of Jesus. Every power attacking my multiple assets, my multiple blessings, my multiple investments, I command them to be destroyed by fire in the name of Jesus. Jesus. Now, the worst of it all, Job chapter 1, verse 18 to 19. Job lost all his children. He had 10 children. You know how many years it took him to have those 10 children? Even the first son was already a big boy. And in a particular occasion, all the children came to the first boy, their first sibling, their elder brother, and they were there having a feast. The enemy targeted them when all of them were together, not when some were in school, not when some were in different areas, different countries. The enemy waited for when they would come together. Strategy. The enemy is a dangerous strategist, but our God destroyed his strategies. Jesus. And so he stormed them and destroyed them. There are many children that are under such attack. We are praying for our children. We are asking God to protect them. Anything that will make me to lose my children, let such powers be destroyed by fire. In the name of Jesus. Every storm, every arrow of fire that wants to destroy my family, to destroy my children, or to make them to be living a wasteful life, may God destroy such spirits in the name of Jesus. No. Jesus. I once heard a story some time ago of a family that ate certain mushroom. They didn't know it was poisonous. Everybody in the family, because it was a family meal, all of them died. That is the enemy's attack. Jesus. I know of a family that there was no electricity, and they put generator on, and the exhaust pipe, of course, was emitting carbon dioxide, and they didn't know, you know, because they opened the window for the air to be coming in, they didn't know that the carbon dioxide was not coming in into the house through the window, into the room through the window, and by late night, the wind was blowing and carrying the carbon monoxide into the room. And because they were asleep, they didn't know. And they have inhaled it to the poisonous level that nobody woke up in the morning. The enemy's attack. Many cases where families got completely killed through accidents. The enemy's attack. This was what happened to Job. We are releasing the blood of Jesus upon every of our family members. I will not lose anybody in my family. Open your mouth and declare it. Every power of the devil attacking my family, trying to destroy my family, trying to kill my family, trying to close my family, I cancel this hour. I cancel this hour. I cancel this hour. In the name of Jesus. The Bible says in Numbers chapter 31 verse 49, we counted, and no one is missing. We counted, and no one is missing. I am praying for you that you will count the number in the family, and by the end of the year, nobody will be missing. So every spirit that wants to take life from my family must fail in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, we cover our families with the blood of Jesus. We cover our families with the blood of Jesus. May the blood of Jesus shield our family. May the blood of Jesus sanctify our family. May the blood of Jesus fortify our family. In the name of Jesus. May the blood of Jesus strengthen our family. In the name of Jesus. Every power of the devil against my family, let such power be destroyed by fire. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Papa, come and take over. In the name of Jesus.
Jesus. Now, in Job chapter 2, verse 1 to 10, Job's health was attacked. And we know the rest of the story. May every attack against our health be arrested this night. We release the blood of Jesus upon our health system for restoration. In Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 17, and the Bible says, and I will restore your health and bandage your wounds. I'm praying that God will restore your health and will also bandage your wounds in the name of Jesus. May he deliver you from that hour of sickness in the name of Jesus. May he deliver you from that wicked spirit in the name of Jesus. Jesus. And then, my dear friends in Christ, Satan entered Job's wife and they used her to bring heartbreak to Job. Even used his friends to bring heartbreak to Job. We're asking God to strengthen us, even when the enemy is using household enemies to attack us, using friends, green snake in green grass to attack us. May God deliver us. Frenemies, friends, but enemies. May God deliver us from them. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Masha Karabu. May the Lord protect his people. In the name of Jesus. So as you could see in the life of Job, it was one bad news after another. Doesn't bad news come sometimes in pairs, in bunches? Maybe you have had some bunches of bad news. It is time for good news. Don't we often get the worst news when we're already feeling bad? That's why we have to turn to God and begin to punch the enemy. Begin to paralyze the enemy with the power of the Almighty God. Our God wants to deliver us. In spite of all the things that Job passed through, Job says, I know that my Redeemer liveth. I know that he liveth. Even though I don't understand why this happened to me, but I know he liveth. Job 19, verse 25. And in Job chapter 13, verse 15, the Bible says, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Even though that I have been slain, but I will trust my God. Can you trust in God, even in death, even in suffering, even in afflictions? Job is teaching us today to trust in the Lord. The book of Job is a very wonderful book, and I encourage you, my dear friends in Christ, to make your time and read that book. You can finish it in within 2 hours to 3 hours. And I pray that God will use that message to bless you. That God will use the message of Job to turn your situation around, to strengthen your faith. People that are passing through ordeals in their lives, I am praying that God will strengthen you in the name of Jesus. May the message of God surround you. May God strengthen you. I stand against every spirit of tragedy in your life. May they be destroyed. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. May the blood of Jesus sanctify you. Every spirit engineering troubles in your life, just like they engineered serial problems in the life of Job, may God deliver you. That God that delivered Job, at the end, God delivered Job and even gave him double recompense. May that same God do it for you. May he do it for you in the name of Jesus. Regardless of what kind of personal tragedies you may be enduring now, God himself will always work things together for good for those who love him. According to Romans 8, verse 28. May God see you through. May God turn your suffering into grace, into favor. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10, the Bible says, after you have suffered a while, I will say to you, it is time to say to somebody, that your financial tragedy or hardship or tragedies in your life, I am praying that God will restore you. And he will restore your dignity. Restore all that you have lost, even double-fold, triple-fold, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. May God make a way for you where there's no way. May God fight your battle. May he fight your battle. You cannot fight that battle alone, brother. You cannot fight it alone. May God help you. May God strengthen you. Jesus. May the blood of Jesus sanctify you. May God bless you from Zion. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Ancient of Days. Papa, we thank you for this message of this night. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done, for the message you have used to touch your people. Blessed be your name. Father, we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.